So, we're going to hand over to Robin now. Thank you so much. And can we have another round of applause? Thank you.
Greetings. Okay, so why are we here? Who's here for some powerful black history information? Who's here for that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you're in the right place. This is going to be called A Brief Black History in Time. And the whole point then is to give a very, very brief...
Black children, the Empire Windrush brings to Britain 500 Jamaicans. Many are its servicemen who know England. They serve this country well. In Jamaica, they couldn't find work. Discouraged but full of hope, they sailed for Britain. Citizens of the British Empire coming to the mother country with good intent. Prodded by public opinion, the Colonial Office gives them a more cordial reception than was at first envisaged. Many are to be found jobs.
Are citizens of the British Empire coming to this country with good intent? Right, so I don't want to hear no rubbish about we don't know the status of the Windrush people. I don't want to hear none of that rubbish. Okay, now, there were more black people on the ship than 500 Jamaicans. There were actually 539 Jamaicans, 139 people from Bermuda, 73 Trinidads, 44 people from Guyana, 7 people from other Caribbean countries, and that's 802 people. So there's 802 people on the Windrush. All right, now, Black Britain was not just Caribbean. Who else was here? What's going on? You do now.
July the 22nd, 2013. And Prince George, by countless royal princes before him, is presented to the nation by his proud parents. This timeless scene is part of our national story.
He's a big boy, he's quite heavy.
Standing discreetly behind him is a black woman, their midwife, Jackie.
And her name is Professor Jackie Dunkley Bent. Now, where else did we get to in the National Health Service? Right, this is Dame Carleen Davis. This is Dr. Beverly Malone. Where did they end up? Dame Carleen Davis ended up as the General Secretary of the Royal College of Midwives, the most powerful leader of the Midwives Trade Union. And then Dr. Beverly Malone ended up as General Secretary of the Royal College of Nurses. Now, did it stop there? Do we know who these two gentlemen are? Lord Pitt and Lord Ribeiro? Lord Pitt, President of the British Medical Association, and Lord Ribeiro, President of the Royal College of Surgeons. In other words, we got to the top. Okay, now, what else? Where else did black people make an impact?
With the games only 2 months away, our brightest hopes are reaching their best form at the right time. Quite a number are certainly for a placing at Wembley. McDonald Bailey, coming from nowhere to win the 100 metres in 10.7 seconds, is a serious challenger for high Olympic honours. If he can keep this up, the Trinidad sprinter will make Empire sporting history.
And so McDonald Bailey becomes Black Britain's first Olympian in 1948. And then by 1951, another height had been reached. Did you know that a Black Briton was the heavyweight champion of the world, having beaten Sugar Ray Robinson? The Black Briton is a gentleman from Warwick, and his name is Randolph Turpin. We're going to come back to him. And then the dominance continues. By the time we get to the 70s, John Conte steps out onto the stage, Nigel Benn, Chris Eubank, Frank Bruno, and the best we ever produced was Lennox Lewis, also known as the Lion. The most important thing about him is he achieved the crown for the first time in December 1992 after Riddick Bowe refused to fight him. Simply gave him the crown. There's not even bother fighting over it. All right, so who's at the top right now? Do you see this? Anthony Joshua? And can you also see that there's a book that he's plugging? And that book was written by me and my team, so big up to Anthony Joshua. So if you want to learn about black British history, that's the book. All right, so where else did black Britons have an impact?
And it's bronze.
This scene would have been unimaginable in the 40s for players like Charlie Williams, a football pro with Doncaster Rovers, long before he found fame as a comedian.
I enjoyed my footballing days. Thought they were great. When I ran out, no matter whether there are 40 spectators or 30 or 4,000, they all went, oh, there's a darky playing. And I used to wonder, I'm human. But it wasn't said in any malice, it was just amazement. Because in them days, there weren't many colour footballers. Little did I realise that within 20 years it would be dominated by colour players.
What about that? Yeah?
When will I see you?
With the 3 degrees. And these were the first time a major football team had fielded 3 prominent black players. And they've since been commemorated.
Now, a statue is going to be built to honour former West Bromwich Albion players Laurie Cunningham, Cyril Regis and Brendan Batson.
And guess what? That statue has since been built. And it's not just in sport that we've been blowing up. 1959, this scholar, E.R. Braithwaite, he was a nuclear physicist, but he couldn't practice physics because of the colour bar, so he made a left turn and became a school teacher. He then wrote about his experiences as a school teacher, To Serve With Love. That won a book prize in 1959, then it was televised.
I suddenly realised that you are not children, that you will be adults in a few weeks, with all the responsibilities that imply. So, from now on, you will be treated as such by me and by each other. As adults, responsible adults. Next, we are going to be reasonable with each other. We are just going to talk, you and I. You are going to listen without interruption, and when I am finished, one of you may have your say without interruptions. Next. There are 2 ways to enter a room. One is like an adult, a lady with dignity. The other is like a brat. Ms. Dare has just shown us the second way. Perhaps you would care to demonstrate the first.
And then from there, Zadie Smith was blowing her up with her white teeth, which was then televised into a series. Andrea Levy with Small Island, that became a series. And where did it end up? Did you know a black woman became the children's laureate? Okay, where's the evidence?
Well, on June the 4th, 2013, I was appointed the new children's laureate, taking over from Julia Donaldson. And I have to say, I am so thrilled. I think I'm 95% thrilled and 5% kind of daunted, thinking, oh my goodness me. But I'm so excited about it, because what I want to do in my 2 years is just instill in all the children I can my absolute love and enthusiasm for books and reading. And my aim is quite simple, really. It's more children reading more. So that's my aim, and I'm going to do anything I can and everything I can to kind of make that happen.
Fine art. Elephant Dung Artist Scoops Award. Do you know that 3 black people have won the Turner Prize for Art? And the very first person to do it was Chris O'Feely. Some of you may have seen this particular portrait. Anyone seen this? Okay, for those of you that don't know, this is one of the classics of modern art, and it's a portrait of Lady Doreen Lawrence. And as she's crying, in each tear is a miniature image of Stephen Lawrence. So this is one of the powerful pieces of contemporary art. And then after him, Steve McQueen won the Turner Prize with and he then went on to make the film 12 Years a Slave. Yinka Shonibari ended up on the 4th plinth of Trafalgar Square. But even before that, did you know that one of our artists blew up in the 1950s?
The first group of black artists to find success in Britain were part of the Windrush generation, arriving from the Caribbean from the late 40s.
And one of those artists was Althea McNeish. And she blew up in the 50s. Did you know she was designing for Dior and she was designing for Liberty's? People don't believe me? Evidence.
Althea studied textile design at the Royal College of Art and during her student years created what became her best known piece, Golden Harvest.
Now, this beautiful, vibrant fabric we've got here, it was one of your most famous works at the time.
It was one of my first designs. I visited wheat fields and it reminded me of the sugarcane fields that we have at home. Oh, it was glorious. And I went into the wheat fields, painting away and, you know, having a wonderful time. The whole place excited me.
Soon afterwards, Althea was talent spotted at her graduation show by the hugely influential department store owner, Arthur Stewart Liberty, who set up a meeting in his offices.
And when I saw this man with his cold grey eyes, I said, wow. He called all his buyers from the furnishing, from the dress department, everybody, and they went cuckoo.
Liberty quickly began producing Althea's designs, and soon fashion brands like Dior and Balenciaga also came calling.
And on the subject of textiles, do we know who this person is? The coolest man in the world, definitely. The coolest, the flyest. He's even had a TV series dedicated to him. And the result is textiles in, there's a part of central London, that part of central London, we've got Gentleman's Tailoring, Savile Row. Do you know that there are four houses on Savile Row that are actually controlled by blacks? So we are disproportionately on Savile Row, Gentleman's Tailoring. Even politics.
Behind the young pages, Prince Charles, his robes covering his uniform, walks beside Princess Anne. Awaiting the arrival of the monarch, Lord Constantine.
There he is.
The Archbishop of Canterbury. And the Prime Minister's 80-year-old father.
Lord Constantine is the Black Britain's very first Lord. He became Lord in 1969. So who was next? Lord Pitt. After that, we then get the first Black members of the House of Commons. The cameras were rolling and this happened.
As the returning officer for the constituency of Hackney North and Stoke Newington, I hereby give notice that the total vote number of votes given for each candidate at the election is as follows. Diane Julie Abbott.
Labour.
18,912. And did you know that Diane Abbott made history 3 weeks ago? Anyone been following the story? She became the leader of Her Majesty's opposition at Prime Minister's Question Time, first time. So for that moment when she was leading Prime Minister's Question Time, she was the leader of Her Majesty's opposition. Then there were others. Do you remember these four? Old heads here remember this? Who have we got? Lord Boateng, Keith Furze, Diane Abbott and Bernie Grant. Alright, so what happened next?
On October 23rd, 1997, in a chamber of government with a 750-year history, something new took place. There had never been a black woman admitted to the House of Lords.
And that black woman was Valerie Amos, and she became leader of the House of Lords. Here's the news story. Did we know this? Why is everyone looking at me blank? All right, and then we also have other successes. This gentleman here, Lord Bill Morris, was at one time the leader of the working class movement. He was the head of the TUC and the head of the largest labor union in Britain, the Transport and General Workers Union. And this woman here was at one time the top lawyer in this country, the Attorney General, and that's the government's lawyer and the Queen's lawyer, and she's the only woman in 700 years to have held that position. All right, so the next frontier is business. And where have we ended up in business? Tijian Tian, first black CEO of a FTSE 100 company. But here's the bombshell. African buys Gatwick Airport. That's not quite true. He actually bought three airports and sold one of them. So London City Airport was owned by him as well. He bought it and sold it back on. But he still owns Edinburgh Airport as well as Gatwick Airport. So that black man's name is Adebayo Ogunlesi. All right, so black heritage has now been recognized as British. Here's why. When it comes to the Olympics, you don't get Britishness being presented. And at the Olympics, this is what they presented to the whole world. Empire Windrush.
The men and women of the Windrush generation deserve to be celebrated. And that's why earlier this week, we announced that the 22nd of June will forever be marked as Windrush Day.
And then, so in 70 years, we went from this, Mr. Soundman, is this Soundman there? You turn it down just a bit, it's going to be loud. Well, we went from this, and what's going on in this picture is you can't come in here, colour bar and all that. We went from that to this. Windrush Square has been commemorated. Did I mention the boxer Randolph Turpin? Do you know that he's got a statue to him in Warwick? Tessa Sanderson has got an envelope. There's a place in the Midlands. There's the Sanderson Estate. Danny Thompson's had a street named after him. Tessa Sanderson's had a street named after her. Paul Ince is on a coin. Andrea Levy winning prizes. Yinka Shoni Bari's on the fourth plinth. Naomi Campbell's on a foreign stamp. So, my most recent book is here. I've got a couple of copies. It's going for £12. And thank you very much.